Scalar UDF inlining is a new capability available in SQL Server 2019. Tune into this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition to learn more. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Kathi Kellenberger. Welcome, Kathi. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do?
Thanks, Anna. I'm really happy to be here. I am currently the editor of Simple Talk at Redgate and also a DevOps advocate.
Awesome. Well, we're happy to have you on the show. And today you're going to talk about something I don't know a ton about. So I'm looking forward to learning as we go through this as well. Now, I think we're going to talk about Scalar UDFs and kind of, you know, what they are and how they've changed through our implementations. But I was hoping you could just start and give our viewers a 100 level, like what are Scalar UDFs and what are they used for?
So UDF stands for User Defined Function. And a lot of shops will like to use UDFs to kind of hide code complexity and make their queries look prettier. And the scalar part means that one value is returned. So this might be a function that a team comes up with just so, you know, they can use it inside a select list or an order by. So that's what they are.
Awesome. Thanks, Kathi. That really helps. Now, you know, from a performance standpoint, are there any issues with leveraging these types of functions?
Unfortunately, yes. While using functions like in this manner in regular code is a great idea, sometimes it's not so great for SQL Server. And it's really been one of the red flags when I was doing consulting work. A lot of times I would, I remember one time got a query to go from like a half hour down to a few seconds just by eliminating the Scalar UDF
and
having the straight code there. So yeah, there are a lot of issues.
And over time, and I think maybe in either 2017 or 2019, we did add some new capabilities. Can you tell us a little bit about those?
Yes. In 2019, as part of the intelligent query processing, Microsoft added this new feature called UDF Scalar Inlining that kind of does what I was doing for my consulting customers. It just puts that formula or query or whatever is inside that function straight into the select list. You don't see that. You still get the benefit of having that complexity hidden, but the performance can be better.
Awesome. Cool. And I think, you know, you have some examples. Can you show us kind of how this works and how we can implement it and maybe some of the challenges?
Yeah, I would love to. So Anna, we talked a little bit about the performance problems that you can see with user-defined functions. And here I've got an example. So let's say we're running SQL Server 2017, which I'm simulating by setting the compatibility level. And I'm running a query against a couple of big tables. These are from Atom Mechanic, a couple big tables for AdventureWorks. And inside here, I have this formula that could be more complex. This one's not too complicated, but when I run it, this query should just run in just a few seconds. And let's see, probably about 5 or 6. I'm going to come back to that if it doesn't stop soon. So, oh, there it goes, 12 seconds. So typically I've seen it 5 seconds, 8 seconds. So let's say that we use this formula all the time, and it would be really great to have a function instead of that in a dozen queries or 100 queries or whatever. So I'm going to create this function. It just basically returns the answer. It's got the same formula that you saw before. And I go in and decide to change my code to take advantage of this new function. Now, I'm not going to run this because it took over 5 minutes to run when I tested it earlier today. So that's a lot of issues. So what's really cool is that some of these functions, especially a simple one like I just showed you, if you are running SQL Server 2019, it should one, notice I'm still using that UDF here, it should run much, much quicker. So I don't know if it's, there we go. So this time 7 seconds. So it's really cool for very simple functions like that.
That's awesome. And it seems like I didn't have to, or you didn't have to change any code. You just upgraded the compatibility level and you were much faster.
Exactly. So that was a really simple function. So there are some other types of functions that folks might have. So here's one that has a query inside it. We pass in a product ID in a year and it returns the number of units sold for that year. So that's a little more complicated. And actually you could, instead of doing this in a function, you could just have this in your query. But again, a lot of folks don't want to repeat code and they want to make their query simpler. So if I run this in a this function I just created in a query, and it ran pretty quick because this is a small table. If I am doing some troubleshooting, let's say there was a large number of rows, I might want to look at the execution plan. In 2017, the execution plan is going to look something like this, where everything that's happening inside the function is inside this black box compute scalar operator, and you really can't see it. Now, I noticed that in Azure Data Studio, you do get some more information. I don't have that here, but which is useful, but you still have the problems. This is what it looks like whenever you, let me zoom in a little bit, whenever you're using 2019 and this feature, we can actually see that we're touching these tables, where before, with 2017, we could only see that we were touching the product table. So this is really misleading, and it's hard to know, you know, hard to really know what you're working with whenever you're query tuning or just troubleshooting. One thing that I like to show is an extended event. And what this extended event is doing is capturing the statements that are running inside that UDF. And notice that I've got 997 rows affected. So basically, I've got two lines for every time that function ran. So what's happening is it's calling that function and it's querying those tables once for every time that for every row in the outer query. And that's part of the reason they're so slow. It'd be a lot faster if you just wrote a join. But again, make sure writing your queries harder, right? There are some other things you can do in functions. You can do tons of things in functions. And some of the other, I've shown you a formula. I've shown you a query, but here's one that's got an if statement. That's something you can do in a function. Luckily, this you can also inline. Did I say at the beginning what this feature was? SQL Server is inlining. So basically what's going on is the optimizer is taking that code and kind of stuffing it in the select list. You know, you don't really see that. It's happening under the covers. So for one like this, it actually can be inlined. The simpler, the better, though, I think, at this point. If you have a loop, a while loop, sorry, that is not going to work. And if you think about that, how would you put a while loop in a select list? You couldn't do it. Here's one, table variables. You cannot have a table variable. I mean, you can, but it's not going to inline. You can also nest. So here I've got one where I'm nesting. I'm calling another one that's not inlineable. Basically, what would happen is the optimizer would just add this function to that expression in the select list. There's a lot of different things, and if you go out to the documentation, you'll see a bunch of requirements for this to actually work. And really, the simpler, the better. But there is a query you can run to find out if your function is inlineable. So that very first one I showed you that just had the select list, yes, it is inlinable, and I showed you that it was. If I add an if block, it still is. Once I add a loop, no. The nesting shows that it is, but so you got to really be careful because under the covers, it's not going to be. And here's one with the table variable. So this is really helpful, but there could be situations where you think that is going to meet the requirements, but it really doesn't. So one thing you can do to find out is take a look at the XML of the execution plan. And if you see a section like this, that means that it was not in line. The optimizer said, sorry, this is too complicated, or it doesn't meet the requirements.
This is really interesting and really powerful kind of gotchas for me to be aware of as I go through these or viewers go through using these. Just to kind of recap, what you're saying is that if I use, you know, these types like the table or the while loop, it will still, you know, run, but and say that it's okay, but in the back end, it's not going to be using that inlining capability. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly. So it's you're not going to get that performance benefit that you might be expecting by upgrading in those situations.
So. Okay, awesome. And these are some awesome tips of how you can kind of check, you know, even though you think it's going to be okay, you know, you can double check that it is inlinable. That's really cool. I've never seen that.
Another thing I wanted to show you is that you can control when it's used. There might be situations where inlining is not what you want to do. And I have an example of that. So you've seen me turn the functionality on and off throughout this demo just by changing the compatibility level. And that actually will enable or disable all of the IQP features. If you don't want any of them, you know, or you accidentally have it at the wrong compatibility level, you won't get them. If you decided you just don't want this particular feature, but you want the others, you can use this alter database scope command to turn it on or off, just that command. But you might do some testing and find out that you have a few queries that it causes a problem. And I've got an example. Here's a query or a function that has a, it calls this table that doesn't exist. Okay, so it checks first to see if the table's there. If it is, let's get the count from there. If not, we're going to get it from this other table. And the query or the function does compile, does run. And if I'm running in 2019 and I have everything turned on, it works, but I get an error message. This doesn't light up red. If I was doing this in Management Studio, it would light up red. That may be a problem for you. And what you can do is use a query hint to disable it for just that particular query. So here it ran perfectly and it did not produce that error. So that's really all I wanted to show you. I have a couple of resources I think that you'll make available to our viewers. And there's one, just one more point I want to bring up that at this time, at least last week, it was not, this feature was not available in Azure SQL database. It's one of the very few times that something shows up on premises before the cloud. Usually it's the other way. So that's it.
Awesome. Thanks, Kathi. This has been really, really interesting and informative. And not only did you show us what Scalar UDFs are, but how they can be improved with really no code changes by us with this new feature called inlining. And you've also showed us some of the gotchas and how we can kind of track if inlining is going to apply or when inlining might not actually make sense. So I just want to thank you so much for being on the show today, Kathi.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a lot of fun.
It's been fun. And we'll put some links to your references as well as Simple Talk in the description. So we encourage our viewers to go check that out. And viewers, if you liked this episode, please like this episode. Leave us a comment of what you're doing with Scalar UDF inlining and subscribe to our channel. We'll see you next time on Data Exposed.